delighted to present our two guests this morning. It's a very, very interesting session this morning, and I'm sure we're all going to benefit a huge amount. Our first speaker, Rachel Cressy, is professor and chair of geriatrics at the University of Basel in Switzerland. And he is also one of the principal investigators of one of the most significant and currently the biggest European Union project on healthy aging. He's going to start this morning with a lecture that will last about 45 minutes, and then we'll have some time for questions before we move on to our second part of the morning, which I will present at that point. Okay, so welcome, Professor Cressy.
Et tous, comme ce soir au Canada, comme j'ai appris, il faut quand même commencer en français. Et j'aimerais tout particulièrement tout d'abord remercier les organisateurs, et là je pense tout particulièrement à Louise, José, John, qui ont beaucoup insisté que je vienne. Malheureusement, demain je dois déjà repartir, donc ça veut dire que c'est vraiment un séjour très court, je n'aurai pas vraiment le temps de découvrir toutes les beautés. So, having me speaking about the topic, music, movement, and the brain, it's not evident that I can be here. I'm a physician, a medical doctor, and most of you, you're musicians, you're artists, you're aerobics teachers. So I'd really like to thank you for your open spirit that you look at these things also, or you're open to look at these things also in a medical way. Now, you've heard I'm a geriatrician, so I'm taking care of older patients, and of course, that's going to be my topic now. I want to see what is the meaning of music and movement and the link to cognition in particularly older adults. And being a geriatrician, of course, I have a lot to do with deficits, decline, and let me phrase it this way. We look at it in a very positive way. We always try to see the half full glass, and I think that's the most important task we have as geriatricians. We work on quality of life, and we also started working about prevention years ago. Prevention, how can we prevent decline? How can we stay fit until 80, 90, 100? And that's how I would love to start this lecture. Maybe some of you know me. This is my oldest patient. She died a few years ago. It's Mademoiselle Neff. She was the first assistant of Emil Charles. It's at her 108th birthday. She's giving a lesson, a Eurythmics lesson. So I see you have some problems to understand.
I see you're going in and out.
Okay, so maybe I'm not standing at the right position. Normally, you know, you should stand there, but I like to be mobile. I also want to stay mobile, so maybe it's going to work. So just having seen those pictures, but then we have to take it away because that's going to not go together. Give me an advice what I should do. Like this? Okay. So, I mean, I always have hope when I see this, and I think that's also hopefully going to be the result of my lecture, that it's going to be very positive. How you're going to age yourself and how you can stay fit. Now, my corner, or where I'm coming from, you can see that on this slide. These These are the most important problems we face in geriatric medicine. We call them geriatric giants. And you see, immobility and stability, these are very important parameters, important factors for an independent life. So you can see some results that if you're unstable, if your gait is not safe, you fall, you can break the hip. So a lot of problems are linked to mobility. And in fact, looking at mobility of human beings in general, it's something very complicated. Just to walk from A to B, you really need a lot of organ system to work together in a very correct way that you really arrive at the point B. So, just as a few examples, you have to have a good vision, you have to see where you're going, you have to have a good hearing, but you also have to have enough strength, and muscle power. And of course you have to feel where you put your foot. So we call that proprioception. So that gives you the information how you walk and where you walk. And of course, the better you feel, the safer you feel. And something that we have somehow neglected for many, many years is that these different organ systems, they are orchestrated by the brain. We need that motor control, taking control of all those different systems that we have a good posture, that we do not fall, that we have a safe gait. Now, you know, when babies come to this world, they are not able to walk. There are some animals, they kind of giving birth and they stand up and they walk. So, of course, it is complicated, so we have to learn how to walk. Now, everyone in here who has children, I mean, you have experienced how this works, because, well, of our own walking, I think we don't really remember how we have learned that. But something I think is very important for this audience is, how do we learn a motor pattern? How do we learn, for instance, walking? And it, for all the movements we do and that gets into the memory, it's the same system. So if you want to start dancing salsa and you want to learn that, or if you just are a baby and you want to just learn walking, it's always in the same pattern. You start doing this new activity very slowly. That's here, we call that the exploration phase. And for doing that, if you're doing so, you need a lot of attention, attentional resources. And if you look, and we can do that today in functional imaging, we can see which part in your brain is active when you're doing this activity. We're very much concentrated and we need a lot of attention. You see it is the frontal brain and maybe the parietal brain, and so the side. Parts of the brain that are active. But now, I mean, you were at the dance class and you repeat the movement several times and then finally you get it in a way that you can do it almost without any tension because it has sunk into your memory, in your motor memory, and well, it's getting automatic, this movement. And what is very interesting for us as physicians is to see that the activity in the brain is not at the same location anymore. It is much deeper. It's what we call the subcortical brain, or even on a spinal level. So it's completely automatic. We walk and we do not really have to concentrate. It just goes by itself. Well, now, if you picture that, with these two celebrities just walking down those stairs. How much attention do you think do they need just to get where they want to get to? So, I like this picture a lot. I don't know if you know the movie The Devil Wears Prada. Well, guess what? The former Pope, he also was wearing Prada. But so just picture now, in this situation, there is a journalist asking a question. What's going to happen? Is this going to happen? Something that a very smart physical therapist in Sweden has tried out, and she made a study about it. It's a little more looting. She was just observing her patients when she was getting them at the waiting room, and then she had to go to the treatment room, and there was a long hallway. And during that walk in the hallway, she was asking a question: what again is the name of your oldest grandchild? And then she was just observing, was the person stopping to give the answer, or was the answer given by walking? She could show that 80% of the patients who stood still to giving the answer were falling in the upcoming 6 months, in contrast to those patients who just gave the answer by walking. They, I mean, hardly didn't fall at all. So that brings me to the idea, how could we research better the walking, the gait of older people? And I mean, you see a little bit the problem we are facing. I mean, we don't want to measure gait and torturing at the same time our patients. So that's the reason why I started. Well, almost 20 years ago, I was among the first ones doing that, to look at gait of older adults in a way that doesn't hurt. You just walk over the carpet, you see that here, and in that carpet you have sensors, they are linked to a computer, and with the software we immediately can see what's happening on the floor and how long the steps are. And so I don't want to really get into all those details. We have published, I mean, all the necessities that are required when you want to do this in older adults. So whenever there's someone who would like to have those papers, just email me, I will send it to them. So I think the only thing coming from that gait analysis today you should remember is there is one thing that extremely is important for safe gait. This is not the speed, it's not the length of your stride, it is gait regularity. So we are looking at the amount of millimeters that you see when you take one step, the next step, and another step, and we see how much this differs from one step to the next, to the following one. So you see, I mean, I tried here to show it. So we look at the first, we call it gait cycle, then at the second, the third, fourth, and so on. And we can calculate what I call a coefficient of variation. And if this is zero, that means, oh, there is no change. That means you're walking very regularly. But if this is getting higher and higher, that means you have an irregular gait. Now, what's the meaning? What's the clinical impact of that? Well, you will be surprised that even a very small irregularity, so just when your stride length from one to the next differs from 1.7 centimeters, so this is about this much, very small, your likelihood of a future fall is increasing by 2, so it's double. So it goes very fast, just slightest changes are correlated to a higher fall risk. So what has that to do with the brain and with cognition? I'm showing you here another graph that shows how gait is changing in patients with Alzheimer's disease, with Alzheimer's dementia. And you know that Alzheimer's dementia patients, they can fall quite often. And thanks to that technique of gait analysis, we now know that, in fact, with the progressing disease, the gait variability is increasing. So the more affected by the disease you are, the more irregular your gait is. So we see that CDR1 means mild dementia, this is moderate dementia. You see over time, the time frame was 2 years in those nursing home patients. You see how this variability, this irregularity goes up with the progressive disease. So there is some link to the brain. So if we have damage, apparently, gait gets more irregular, and it explains in a certain way why older adults suffering from dementia can fall more often than those who have no dementia. However, and that's for me as a specialist, that's very interesting in that study, it also shows there are patients with dementia, they do not fall. But we can find out who those are, they have a low irregularity. So just looking at the gait, that tells us, is this a patient at high or at low fall risk? Yeah, we try to think about a lot about this link between brain and walking. And here also, I don't want to go into details, but we published that, so if ever you're interested, you also just email me and I'll send it to you. Now, when I just spoke now about dementia and gait irregularities, it might be surprising for you that apparently, and we have very nice data from New York, the US, from Joe Borghese, who is the principal investigator of the Einstein Aging Study. This is a cohort study where just every year, almost the whole neighborhood of the Bronx neighborhood is analyzed in regard of gait and cognition. And then so those people are followed over the years. And this study started in the late 90s. And Joe, he has the same gait analysis system like I do. And after a certain time, he was able to recognize that some of those people living in the Bronx and participating in the study, they got demented. So what did he do then? He went back and looked how was their gait, and particularly their gait regularity, 5 years, 10 years before. And he could show that in fact, compared to those who didn't get dementia, those with dementia already had gait changes in regard of a higher variability 5 years ago. So before even memory complaints started. And I think this is very important for me that I could tell you today and that you will remember it. The brain activity is not just memory. The brain does a lot of things. Apparently it has a lot of meaning also in regard just of how we walk. So it seems like that in regard of complaints we see as a sign for dementia, memory complaint, I mean that is preceded by other slight changes years before, but we only can see them when we are looking for them. Now, a very important concept in geriatric medicine in this recent year is dual or multitasking. Why? We really tend, in regard of identifying a common problem at a very early stage, not just to look at people, how they perform in certain tasks. No, we always try to have them perform tasks under a certain stress. Why? Because then we can find out, do they still have enough reserve to resist to stress? If they don't, then we can recognize a coming problem much earlier than if in daily life we can see it. So that's why we developed this concept of multitasking, just to recognize problems earlier, and of course always with the hope then we can act, we can do something at the time where there is still a lot to do. Well, I was among the first ones looking at these concepts of dual tasking, and that's one of my first studies I did. See, that's already 10 years ago, where I was just looking at our hospital when the patients were admitted. How were they doing? How were they walking? And if they were able to walk, I measured their gait on the carpet you just have seen. And I not only had them walk normally, of course, that's always how I started, but I also had them walk and simultaneously perform cognitive tasks. And then I was measuring the gait and I was looking for changes. Were there changes while they were walking? And at the same time, they had to do other cognitive tasks. Yeah, we looked, and you remember this paper that I showed from Lillemor Lunding, the physical therapist from Sweden. So, of course, stops walking or having changes, gait changes while walking, while doing tasking. Is this a very good predictor for falls? One of my seniors, Ulrike Boschi, by the way, now is chair of geriatrics, not that far from here, he is in Montreal, at McGill. So a former collaborator of mine is now also working in Canada. He looked at all the papers that since then have appeared, and you see there is a very strong message that if you have a problem with dual tasking, walking and talking, then you have apparently a quite high risk of future falls. So what are we doing? I just show you how we normally assess our patients. You see here a patient walking. She is 72 years old, and she was dressed to our mobility lab because she is falling apparently 3 up to 5 times a week. You have seen her walking. I mean, what the heck? I mean, if I still walk like that at 72, I would be more than happy. But now look how she is walking when at the same time she has to enumerate animal names. Just give me as many animal names as you can during that walk. Well, it already looks quite different. Now we have another task. A working memory task, very simple. She has just to count backwards, starting at 50, 49, 48, 7. And look how she's walking. She's wobbling, almost falling. And interestingly, at the end of the carpet, when she touched the wall, that's the task they have to do. We were asking, well, how are you doing? And she didn't even see or mention that she was walking like that. She was just upset that she was not better at counting. But now we know that there is a problem. And I'm very fortunate that at my clinic, the GAID lab is in the same building like the memory clinic. So we had her tested, and she has what we call a mild cognitive impairment, which is a possible starting stage of a future dementia. And I don't know, this was also in Canada, Vancouver, a few years ago. We presented quite a bit of data from Basel in regard of gait and cognition. And we were able to show that particularly this dual task paradigm was extremely precious to predict the difference between mild cognitive impairment and normal cognition. You see, I mean, that even was hitting the New York Times. I see 1,100 elderly people in Basel we analyzed, and yeah, it was in all the newspapers that, in fact, just looking at gait in a very precise way might be a very helpful additional way to put down the diagnosis of a starting, an early cognitive decline. What did we do? We just looked at this dual task gait variability, and you see in regard of that early stage of, we call it mild cognitive impairment, how it is different. You see the variability is higher, much higher compared to healthy, cognitively healthy individuals. Now, we have spoken about brain and brain function now these former days. I would like to show you a particular part of our brain, of our human brain, and interestingly, just us, we human beings, we have this part. It is the frontal part. And if you look at evolution of the human being, this is the part that came in last. So it's the youngest part of our brain, and at the same time, the biggest. It's the frontal brain, you see. Only us humans, we have a big frontal brain like that. And of course, I think it's quite obvious, everything that qualifies us as human beings is located in that frontal brain. So having feelings, having emotions, being angry, everything is in that frontal. But of course, also all the very complicated stuff you're doing, planning, abstract thinking, really addressing complex problems in different steps, and not forget what we did as first step when we arrived at the fifth step. So that is frontal brain, and this brain function, we call it executive function. It's just a definition, I think. That it's worth knowing. And of course, if you're doing several things at the same time, it also takes a lot of frontal brain that you can perform that successfully. And now let me just bring the music in. Thanks to functional imaging, what is that? We can show today which parts in the brain are active right now. It would be interesting to see which brain parts right now are active in yours. But here I brought you an example of musicians. Normally this is done in scanners, so you lay in these scanners and you cannot really move. You shouldn't move, because if you want to take a picture, the head really stay still. But what we can do is we can listen to music, for instance. We did that, or in this study they did that. They were testing musicians and non-musicians, and for both groups they were able to listen to music. It was a Beethoven symphony, and then they got a few tasks. So they were laying in the scanner, had their earphones, and the music was running, and you see the musicians and the non-musicians, they had to accomplish two tasks. The first task was just to listen particularly to the first voice of the violin. Quite easy task. So you see now activity, you see the whiter, the more yellow here, and we are in the frontal brain, you see. And you see that for musicians, maybe it gets red, but it's not white, because it's such an easy task. They don't really concentrate. However, the non-musicians, you see, I mean, they're quite blinking. Here you see these reddy white spots or yellow spots showing there's a lot of activity in the frontal brain, because they have to concentrate to listen or to find this first voice. Now, the second task, that was, I think, the interesting one, so they were kind of asked, well, just to lean back and enjoy the music. Just don't think nothing, just enjoy the music. And there, now you see, all of a sudden, the musicians, they start blinking, and the non-musicians, maybe they have a little problem just to enjoy it, so they have a bit less. But what I just want to show you here, so listening to music, and not just as background, really careful listening, That has a lot to do with brain activation in that frontal part of your brain. Yeah, no wonder having a music activity throughout life has an impact on your brain. And these studies now, they start coming out. I brought you a few ones from the last years, just showing that if during your life you have more than 10 years of musical activity, and you see for high activity musicians, in different neuropsychological testings, that's how we look how the brain functions, they are much better than their parents who didn't do any music. Here another example showing particularly one quality that you can much better deal with auditory processing, so you're able to listen better. I think here there is less decline in hearing speech in noise. Maybe familiar with that problem. You're in a room with a lot of people, everyone speaks, and you would like to speak just with your neighbor, and it's hard to hear what you want to hear and just to kind of focus out what you don't want to hear. So apparently doing music all over your life helps in regard of that activity. This is something very similar. You just see how also you are able to react faster than healthy pairs without music experience. Here you see when your children, I don't have children myself, but my friends, they tell me, well, we have now our daughter, she started playing piano. I also play piano, so I love playing piano. But very often these children, they don't really like it, or it's kind of, you have to force a little bit. So I say, well, if you can force them at least for 4 years to do so, then you see, you're gonna have a much better aging process, which of course the child will not really care at that moment. But I think that's a parent's responsibility to do the very best for their children. And even if the children don't really get it, I mean, then I think it's your call to try to get them to this position. Yes, and also the fact that you are never too old to start playing an instrument. Here a very, very nice study just showing that if you are 60 up to 85 and you start playing the piano, after 6 months already you can see changes, improvements in your brain function. Yeah, and this brings me to the Dalcross Olympics. That's how I got started with this group. This is the group in Geneva that was for years taught by Mademoiselle Neff, the lady I showed you at the very beginning, the assistant of Emile-Jacques Dalcross, and right now it's still ongoing, and it's Ruth, who we're going to see afterwards, who is training there. And I was so amazed when I saw that. Average age is 80 years old, and I tried to participate. Well, at that time I didn't know at all what Eurythmics was. I had to give up very quickly, and of course the ladies were laughing at the young doctor. Yeah, I was also quite young then. But, and that was the good thing, I asked them, would they be so kind and come in my gate lab that I could just investigate a few things, because I thought, that's something I got in the very beginning. You have to multitask when you do the Eurythmics. So I thought, well, I think they might be excellent in my task in the lab. And yes, indeed, they were. Look at that. Walking alone, the gait regularity 2.1. And you see 2.7 when they had to accomplish an additional task. So it hardly didn't change. I took a comparison group, of chess players matched their age and sex, so I was hoping that they wouldn't be too bad either, because playing chess is quite a demanding game. But look at that, they were already starting at a much higher irregularity, 3-9, and it formally exploded under that simple duo. So we were able to publish that in the Journal of American Geriatric Society. And yes, I was still very young, but that put me on the map, because when you can publish something in this journal, that means this is rock science. So finally, this gait analysis for older people got some recognition for that, and the people were just laughing. That comes again with the flying carpet, that's what I mean. Yeah, so of course now the question was, doing eurythmics like you just saw in these ladies for over 40 years, that's very nice, but I would be very much too old already to start now to get 40 years of experience. So the question was for me very quickly, can we have some benefits in regard to gait regularity and multitasking if we start now? You're 60, 70, or even 80. Is it worth it starting eurythmics at that age? Can you expect still some advantages? And having quite a lot of experience in clinical trials, I know that even if you come up with the best intervention, it's worthless if people don't want to do it. So before really running a big trial, I always run pilots. I just look, what's the adherence rate? Are the people really coming every week? Or is this just an excitement for 2 weeks and then afterwards they think, well, let's just go and do something else? Well, you just saw now this short video clip. That was one of the first pilots we did with, I call them Dalcroze naive older adults. They have never touched at that, so they just started doing that, and we did that in Geneva also a few years ago. And look, 84%, that was the attendance rate. And something we really need when we run clinical trials in geriatric medicine, we need an adherence rate of at least 80%. So I felt already quite comfortable with that result. But then, well, we went a little bit further, and we were mixing kindergartners with seniors. And I mean, look at those pictures. Particular look at the attendance rate for seniors and children, over 90%. So what's the message here? It also depends a lot on how you offer something like that. If this is even in a, we call that intergenerational setting, apparently this is worthwhile trying. Apparently for the attendance rate, it's quite helpful. And it's very interesting. Of course, you saw here now pictures. That was during the trial, that pilot trial we were running. And this is still ongoing. You never would imagine why. It has become an immigration project. The community where we did that found out that the kindergartners at the age then when they went to school, they spoke a much better German than did the pairs who were not in the trial. And I didn't even know that in this community, there were a lot of immigrants with problems of language. So it's running now, yeah, it's an immigration project, it's financed by the state, and I don't care what's the reason, I'm very happy for the seniors. Yes, and then we went and we came to the big trial, and now we have heard about this already several times now this week. We did that in Geneva, where we were able to show that if you practice eurythmics once a week over 6 months, you considerably are improving your dual task capacity. And not only that, you're decreasing your falling risk by over 54%. And I tell you, as a researcher, having this result, this is very nice, but your task isn't finished, accomplished yet. I think the most important is to get that result into daily practice. So what I tried hard now these last 10 years in Switzerland, that's really to make senior Olympics popular. And while in Basel I was quite successful, after years of trying, I finally was able to convince the health department. And the health department of Basel City is offering Dalkurs Eurythmics in all the neighborhoods of the city, almost for free. They have to pay 5 francs each time they come, but of course this is just a little contribution, and the costs are major taken overtaken by the state. And look, I mean, every week 300 citizens, senior citizens in Basel are performing Eurythmics. And tendency is still increasing. After more than 6 years, they tried to stop it once, and there was so much resistance in the newspapers, from politicians, and so the Minister of Health, he called me and said, yes, well, we have to save money, but we will save it elsewhere. So, yes, and now, can we do Eurythmics in patients with dementia? Yes, you can, but it takes a lot of patience, but it is working. You see here, this is a patient with a very, very advanced patient, with advanced dementia. And while we're working a lot with volunteers, these are cognitively healthy people just volunteering. And what we see in those patients, they improve their communication skills. They also improve some of their behavioral patterns that sometimes are very difficult. And yeah, music is used a lot in the treatment also of Alzheimer's disease. You see that if you are singing a text, having Alzheimer's, you can remember it. If you're just speaking, you won't remember. Again, if the text is sung, then you will remember. If it's just spoken, you won't. And what to me is also very, very helpful is just using music interventions in advanced dementia. It helps a lot for those behavioral problems that sometimes are really difficult to live with for the families and the caregivers. Yes, you see the well-being is better with music intervention. There are a lot of small studies, but they all show the same. So there's really a lot of evidence that music, when the brain is not working properly anymore, can help considerably. I want to kind of conclude with this very important and to me extremely interesting finding that was presented a few years ago at the Max Planck Institute in Germany. What you see here in this brain, this little red spot, that's the music memory. That's where your songs that you were singing when you were a child, they are stuck there. And interestingly, even by in a dementia disease that is progressing, these researchers were able to show that almost until to the end stage of the disease, this part of the brain is not affected. It's working. So that explains why at a very advanced stage of dementia you can still remember texts of songs that you have sung as a child. That was to me always very amazing to see that someone was not able to speak anymore. Then there was someone sitting at the piano kind of playing the national song of Switzerland, and they knew all the words that I never knew. So. Yes, so maybe this, as a short note also, I mean, just showing it is not a genetic thing. It's something we heard at the very first lecture in this conference, that there is no excuse. You cannot say, well, I'm not a musician, or I'm not into music, and that this would be a genetic thing. Either you are interested or not. There are twin studies showing that the twin who was doing music during her life, was protected, didn't get dementia, while the other twin who didn't do music was it. So this is not a chicken excuse. And that also gives a lot of hope that this is another result of the Einstein aging study showing that playing a musical instrument or dancing during life is decreasing the risk of Alzheimer's dementia by 8 years. Yeah, I hope that I have shown you that also at an advanced age, there is a preserved neuronal plasticity which comes into play during musical training. So it's never too late to start an instrument or engage into eurythmics. So we can do that at the age of 80 and you will still be able to expect benefits. And having said that, I thank you very much for the attention and for having me.
En fait, je peux vous dire que c'est une excellente question, parce que vous avez raison. Vous avez raison, il y a tellement d'évidence scientifique que le côté social, une bonne vie sociale, ça a un effet tellement positif sur l'activité cérébrale que maintenant c'est même considéré comme une activité protectrice par rapport au déclin cognitif. C'est clair, 45 minutes, c'est extrêmement court. Hein, je ne pouvais pas en fait, vous montrer tout, mais je pense que si vous suivez un peu, même dans la presse quotidienne, l'intérêt porté à ces questions est immense, parce que bien évidemment, si nous, maintenant, les baby-boomers, peuvent faire quelque chose pour diminuer le risque d'un déclin cognitif, je pense qu'il y a quand même pas mal de gens qui vont saisir cette opportunité.
Yes. I think the question was to do with effective.
Yes, just. I mean, what's socializing? What's the importance of socializing in this activity? And I think that's something, of course, you see in your lessons. I mean, there's a lot of laughter. There's a lot of socializing before and after. So there is a lot of scientific evidence that socializing is an important protective factor in regard of cognitive decline. So there are even interventions, they call it lifestyle interventions, where socializing group activities is a part of the intervention. And the first results just were coming out. This is a Finnish study, Finger it's the name of the study, and showed that just with lifestyle modification and socializing is a part of it, you can have better cognition after 2 years. I mean, it's what she says is so true. I mean, it's all the emotion that goes with the music, and of course it is linked to the memory. So I showed you that the music memory is conserved even in demented patients, and of course that emotional part, as I told you, is an activity of the frontal brain, the biggest part of our brain, and there's a lot of reserve also in this frontal lobe. So as more as you stimulate it with music, the more activity you get out of it, and the more you can improve your cognitive performance.
Okay, I think there's a question just back here. Yes.
Can gait variability and parameters maybe used as a diagnostic tool, or are they just indicators?
Well, we use it. We use it at the memory clinic. Each of our patients coming for a brain checkup, we have them walk, but of course we don't just have them walk normally, so they also have to perform those dual task paradigms. I know, I mean, here in Canada, there are many labs doing that. I'm very proud that I got them initiated. I really think the dementia diagnosis is not a simple diagnosis, and it's never going to be possible just to analyze gait and say, well, you have Alzheimer's. It's a risk factor, and you have a lot of other additional exams you have to run to come up with a diagnosis that is, I would say, sure for 98% today.
I think we have a question here.
Yes.
If you have some experience with a really good musician, but even if he or she is showing some symptoms about Alzheimer, if it's possible to work with the arrhythmia and even getting better, something.
Yes, of course. I have plenty of experience. I'm seeing many patients with dementia, all types. Alzheimer's is the most frequent type, but there are other dementia types, and I can say also, because I'm involved in a lot of therapeutical trials, I'm seeing patients from all over the world, and of course there are a lot of musicians also among those patients. And I tell you, it's amazing. It's amazing how different the approach can be in patients having a music experience. And so of course, yes, we work a lot with these resources. It is a resource, as I told you, that the memory, that brain part is functioning very well, even in the very advanced stage. And coming back, to the other comment, just seeing that you have a lot of emotions going with that music is playing. It might be interesting for some of you to know that the emotional intelligence is conserved almost at the end of the disease. That means if the cognitive intelligence is gone, the emotions are still recognized correctly by the patient. That's why I always say it's so important, how you approach those patients, even if they don't know your name. They will feel how you feel. And very often, you're going to see in the mirror how you are feeling. When I get calls at night from a ward, and they're saying, oh, Mr. So-and-so is behaving not properly, just could we give him some neuroleptics just to calm him down? I know it's not the patient, it's something with the nurse. So it's very important to know that this emotional intelligence that's present almost still at the end of the disease, and you can work with that. Emotions to just communicate with emotions. It's a wonderful way also for families just to still be in contact with a patient, with a loved one that they think is gone, but no, that's still.
We have just time for one more question.
In German, we would say, that's die Gretchenfrage. That's the main question. And I think I'm able to give you an answer in regard to that.
Yeah, I was just asking you because we talked already about the emotional and social aspects of the practice. And so what makes the difference in the doctors in compared to, let's say, dance or instrumental lessons?
I mean, the proof or I didn't show you that. We did a salsa study, and because also hoping that dancing salsa with older adults who have never danced salsa before, so they were learning that, we were analyzing gait behavior before, after. And while they improve balance, they improve their stride length, their walking speed, but gait variability didn't change. So what I really think what is a major difference between Valkyrie's Eurythmics and other interventions such as dance is that improvisational part that I have learned so much now during this conference. Believe me, I've learned a lot, particularly yesterday when I saw how much thinking behind these exercises. And I really think that you make the participants listen, actively listen to the music, and it's the music telling you to do what you have to do, and particularly also, it's not like salsa dancing, you have always the same step pattern. No, it's changing, and you have to be aware of the changes, you have to pay attention. And just coming back to that graphic, I showed you how memorizing is functioning. So you need in that first stage that attention. You need that attention. If you do not get through that stage, you will never be able to memorize that in a long-term memory. And I think this is the crucial difference with your learning. So that's why I really think you keep on going what you're doing.
Mm-hmm.